So yes, what happens when a child's brain is suffering chronically from the fear, anxiety, stress, and trauma? Their brain is very adaptive. All of our brains are more negatively wired to retain more negativity than positivity. Funny that it should be the opposite, but science is suggesting it. The negative memories and experiences tend to last longer. So, you know, if we're really bottling up so much, it's gonna stay with us for a lot longer. So, sort of like at the ball and chain effect. You know, the more we carry, the more it's gonna get harder and harder and harder. So, talking therapies is very important. Seeing the specialist, finding a friend to connect with, and unloading, getting all that out. The child's brain can have difficulty functioning when presented with a world of enriched kindness, nurturing and stimulation. A lot of these children on the spectrum start out quite positive, quite well, unless genetically predispositioned to a negative environment, then it's a different story. It's really important that they are in that enriched environment, that the parents are kind, nurturing, understanding, supportive, giving so much love. Lots of hugs, lots of kisses, lots of reassurance, but also taking a step back and at times just giving it more verbal appraisal, things like that. Because sometimes you find that parents can be so, which is at one end of the spectrum of, not child abuse, I don't like that word, but neglect is at the other end. So it's important to find balance, I believe. The child is very unfamiliar to the kind world because they have not yet developed the pathways or the capacity in their brain to adapt to the new world. So a negative child must definitely be in a positive environment. That's why my program is very supportive and helpful in that sense. It's just one-on-one, no pressure. I get down on their level, get them to open up and connect with me. We introduce healthy activities that play on the strengths of what they're into. Have lots of fun, of course, and we're very happy. And it's not stressful. And so I think that's why probably 90%+ of the students I've worked with in the last 9 years have always enjoyed coming back on a weekly basis, because they want to escape the negative environment to go into something more positive. Autistic children, I believe, are probably more positive than the neurotypical child. But if a bad experience happens, they can be actually a lot more negative than the common neurotypical. So it's that finding that balance there. So we've got to develop a basic social script. And I think these are just some of my own personal sort of tips. Once again, haven't done any study or research into anything. It's just comes from the heart. I think practicing with a family or a close friend, doing role play, that's a really important one. I did drama and acting for 5 years. That was to express a lot of my own personality. It gave me a lot of confidence, and we did lots of role play exercises. So drama and acting and theatrical play, role play, is very important, I believe, for developing really good, healthy routines or personality or attitude for a child on the autism spectrum. Practicing eye contact until they're feeling a lot more safe. I helped one person last year. She was 35, couldn't make eye contact. She said, "It's like laser beam shooting into my eyes and it hurts painfully." And I just said, focus on something else that's close, so perhaps in between the eyes. And practice visualizing something that you connect well with. It could be an animal or something like that. And just rethinking her mind was all it took. She sent me a long, long testimonial thanking me, because that one change changed her life from someone who didn't even like to be in a selfie or a photo to happily now in photos, can look into the camera, can look at people's faces. I was able to make eye contact because, again, drama, but I actually had a connection with the media, mirrors, cameras. It was, there's a camera, there's a camera, there's a camera, awesome. So every time there's people taking photos, I'm like, each one. Observe the face. Practice that, emotions of another person. Notice all of it, it's all practice. I've put the word practice at the very beginning there, because practice really does make perfection. At least we hope, yes. Practice the small chat, script. Hi, how you going? Good to see you, what have you been up to? It's important they must get educated in what's going on in those current events, or finding interests that they can use to, you know, talk about. Hi, how you going? Good to see you, what have you been up to? Great, awesome, well, I'll see you next time. Keep it, you know, that's a small chat. Work your way up to then the conversation script, something a bit more longer. Challenge them at home, see if they can hold that. Have something written in front and turn it over. So they've got to try and rely on the train of thought, but if they get stuck, turn the piece of paper back over and they can go back. And that's like role play again, like in drama. And just practice doing it until they're, you know, comfortable enough that they don't require any support, that they're independent and they can do that naturally. It's going to be artificial at first. It'll sound completely robotic. But the more that you practice that and just altering slow bits and pieces over time, and I think that's why at times, Mum, I was saying, it's like you're nagging me, correcting my sentences, correcting and making sure that every word was in place so that I was forming proper sentences, and then getting the voice right. So, you know, like a car mechanic, basically, getting everything so it was all working in good order. Ah, my mascot, Captain Confidence. We must develop our own social Captain Confidence. And these guys have to ask themselves, so as parents you could, or teachers, ask them if they do definitely want to have a friend or more friends. These are, I think, questions that all have an answer that's yes. We want to promote yes. Get them to take up an activity that involves participating with others and connecting. Last night I went out with the Asperger's Victoria bowling group, and gee, that was a really interesting experience. Yep. I could do a whole presentation on that. But they were very, very good to be talking and socialising, just if they could all have put their phones away and not be so hunched over. I went up to one and I said, "How you doing? What's your name?" He said, "My name's Edward, but look at my car." Straight away on the phone. I went, gee whiz, we're in for a long night. Continually study and observe others who socially interact very well with others. That one definitely I was doing a lot of. I thought I was a human behavioral therapist probably from an early age and kept that one to myself, but I was always at school observing, observing, observing. How is it that they're doing that so well? And wow, look at him, you know, he's a bully and I don't like him, but he seems to get the respect from everyone else so well, not just because he's a bully, but everyone's looking up to him and he seems so cool. I think they're definitely a lot on the spectrum. Asperger's deep down want to be more cool and have a bit more popularity in some way. So I found my own unique ways, but I observed those that were doing things so naturally. So make sure they find really good positive role models in the community who do that very well. Practice it until it becomes habitual, second language, and just refine things and improve, and over time you'll start to see, as parents or as teachers, that student or individual will just be mastering and picking it up more and more and more, and becoming less unrecognisable, which is what we want. This is a very complicated looking picture right here, but this is exactly what I've just come out of in my neuropsychotherapy course, and it's starting from the bottom to the top, which is what my exercise program was doing all along, is working from the bottom of the brain to the top. A lot of therapies out there are top to bottom approach, so psychology, psychiatry, psychotherapy. Neuropsychotherapy is a more modern day approach, which is going to increasingly create a lot more awareness. It's getting clinicians out there to really rethink a lot of what they might be doing with their clients. And so we start with the environment. The environment is the key to improving a learning capacity. And if the environment is enriched, we will approach more. So you can see the little arrow there. We might be genetically off to a bad start, hypothetically. But if our environment is starting to, you know, work in our favour, and we're feeling safe, as the arrow shows, safety points to the left, Okay, more enriched environment triggers off a more approach, which is what we want. I went from, that's an activity I can't do, there's no way I'll get involved in that, to I had people or support or whatever, good confidence. Actually, no, I feel I will try that. What have I got to lose? So it's up here in the mind. We've got to steer away from avoid. But having said that, we actually are allowed to avoid things as well. So they must definitely learn the balance between avoid and approach. If they're too much approach on things, that can be not ideal as well. So, but too much avoidance is quite common and typical in those on the spectrum. So from approaching, we feel more safety, control, more pleasure, managing pain, emotions, all these sorts of things. But we've got to be motivated. We have to definitely feel more motivated along the journey and feel more supported. If we approach more, we just develop more safety, control in our environment, more positive attachment, increased pleasure, and a lot more feeling of greater self-esteem and confidence. And it's all towards what's called developing the positive higher order self at the very, very top there. That's at the front of your brain. Once this is feeling a lot more positive about ourselves, we're in a lot more self-awareness, we're confident where we are, that's where I am here today on stage, feeling quite happy, relaxed, comfortable. Years ago, it would have been a totally different story. So to work towards that is one thing, and I come from a fitness background. Sustaining that is the hardest bit. When you're at the top, it's hard to stay at the top. And we've all had our moments where we can all very quickly come crashing down. A simple fact, you've got a brain, you've got capacity to go very, very far and successful, or you could be very healthy and the next minute something bad happens and you're on your way down. Okay, so very important that if you come from a bad environment and you've struggled a lot, hey, you know how to do that very well. You've got a lot of resilience. You've developed a lot of techniques to survive. You work towards thrive. So from survive to thrive. Some people thrive, don't know how to survive. They only know success. They only know so well. So I've seen those on the spectrum who are very good until they're under pressure, and then the wheels come off. Whereas if I come from I know what it's like to have the wheels very much off, and I can survive through that if I'm starting to feel that way, I know how to get through that so I can keep the wheels on and keep going. And that's what separates me from most on the spectrum. And unfortunately, I still certainly get bad feedback from other people on the spectrum because of jealousy. They really have this hardwired competitive nature in a way. They sort of try to put me down, saying, oh, you, Jeremy, must have been mild, or you must have. And I go, well, if banging my head as a child and not coping with, you know, my sensory systems all out of whack, if that ain't somewhat severe, and yeah, I don't know, but it's been definitely a journey. So that's my main presentation. I'll get you all, if you've got any questions on that, because I want to move into something a bit more fun now. Any questions at all? No, you're all satisfied. Excellent work. All right, on to the fun bit of the presentation. I think I'm on good time, yes. So I need three volunteers. Three volunteers. Yep. All right. Fantastic, excellent work. All right, who would like to go first? Just three. All right, excellent. What's your name?
Kelly.
All right, Kelly. So this is why I had the chair and everything out. So I'll get to the two of you guys. What's your name? Edie, nice to meet you. Megan, nice to meet you. So Edie and Megan, stand there. All right. Kelly, you get the seat. So don't worry, I'm not going to do any sort of lap dance show or anything like that. So okay, here we go. Welcome, Kelly. Always wanted to be a game show host, guys, so I'm living the dream. Okay. Welcome, Kelly. How are we going? Do you think that you're an autism expert? All right. Well, we'll test your knowledge very, very quickly. And good luck. It's very simple. Just A, B, C, D. You've just got to get the correct answer. There's five questions. If you don't get the question correct, then unfortunately you're out, but there is still a prize for coming up on stage. See what confidence can do, guys? I bet you all think, gosh, I wish I put my hand up now. Alright, so when I read the question, just give a loud, big answer. It's either A, B, C, D. Good luck. Here we go. Question one. How early can autism spectrum disorder be detected in children? Is it A, 1 to 2 months, B, 3 to 6 months, C, 6 to 8 months, or D, 8 to 10 months? Have a bit of a think. What are you leaning towards? Possibly D, 8 to 10 months, okay. Want to lock that answer in? We'll lock it in, D. Kelly, you've locked in D. I wish you all the best. I really hope that it is correct. Here we go. The suspense kills me every time. Unfortunately, it's not D, I can tell you that. So, unfortunately, Kelly, you'll have to... That's the end. I'm so sorry, but well done. I'll give you the prize for third place. Very well done. Our team out there. Quite a little sentry pack there, so well done. All right. Edie, come on down. Have a seat. All right. So, Edie, I'll give you the correct answer. The answer is 6 to 8 months. There we go. So it was C. All right, hopefully the next slide works. Here we go. Question two. Edie, good luck. In what year was the first definition of Asperger's syndrome published? There's no phone. You're told not to have phones on. All right, is it A, 1943, B, 1944, C, 1945, or D, 1946? Okay. What are you leaning towards, Andrew? Lock it in, B. Here we go. Locked in B, 1944. Here it is. Oh, here we go. Good luck, Edie. 1944. Are you confident? Oh, no, there it is. There it is. All right, that's the sound is working. You got it correct. 1944. Well done. Excellent work. All right, only 3 questions to go. Just like that. Question three. Who coined the word autism in 1908? Oh my gosh. Is it A, Leo Stimms? B, Richard Cranial? C, Leo Kanner? Or D, Eugene Bleuler? I can tell you that it's not B. Richard Cranial. Okay. You wanna lock in A? Okay. Locking in A, Leo Stimms. Hope he doesn't. Okay, Leo Stimms. Leo Stimms, is it correct? Oh, bad luck, Edie. It wasn't A, it was D, Eugene Bleuler. Okay, but well done, good, excellent work. And for coming second now, give you a little prize century pack there. Okay. Come on down. Sorry for that, Megan. Was it Megan? Right, Megan. Hopefully you can do it. Hopefully. 2 questions to go. Good luck. Question four. Who said the quote, "See the person, not the label"? Was it A, Albert Einstein, B, Tony Atwood, C, Temple Grandin, or D, yours truly? All right, I'll be fair, because I gave Edie a little clue. It wasn't me, unfortunately. Going for B, Tony Atwood. Are you sure? Okay, that's good. I'm doing exactly what Eddie Maguire does. Okay, so we're not sure about B, so perhaps we won't go for B. Do you think it might be the old Albert? Do you think? Oh, Albert Einstein, do you think he'd come up with something so short like that? See the person, not the label. He usually comes up with something a little bit more longer, because, you know, there's just... So you reckon maybe C? Well, what could C? C, let's go for C, Temple might have said it. We'll find out in about 5-10 seconds, yeah? You Yep. All right, here we go. Was it C, Temple Grandin, C, the person, not the label? I'm sure one of you is out there looking it up on Google. It was Temple Grandin.
Very well done.
All right, well done. One question to go, final question. What is not a common trait of autism Asperger's? A, hyperactivity. B, hypomanic episodes. C, echolalic behaviour. Or D, attachment to objects. So just for the audience, Megan, give us your train of thought. What are you working towards? From leaning towards A, hyperactivity. What makes you think it's A, hyperactivity? Autism Asperger's. We know that there's a lot of stimming and, but yeah, hyperactivity, yeah. Are you 100% with that one? All right, so we're going to lock in, Beck. We're going to go for A, hyperactivity is not a common trait of autism Asperger's. Are we confident about that answer, audience? A few shakes of the head. Ooh, okay. Hyperactivity. Oh, it's not correct, unfortunately. Bad luck, Megan. But because I'm a generous person, well done. I'll give you my exercise DVD anyway. Very well done. Guys in the audience, anyone know the exercise question? Put your hand up.
D.
D. B. B, B, B. Hypomanic episodes. Lock it in. Let's see if hypomanic episodes is correct as a non-common trait of autism Asperger's. Guys, it's been a pleasure to have delivered a presentation that's a bit different. We've had a bit of fun, and it is all about learning more as we go. So I hope you have a great afternoon listening to the other speakers today, and come and talk to myself. My mum will be out there. Hypomanic episodes, is it correct? Please, please be correct. Of course. Hypomanic episodes is more common trait for those with bipolar disorder. There we go. Thank you very much for listening, and I will see you, I'm sure, very soon. But I've got some questions. All right. Beautiful. Excellent. Yes. Echolalic behaviour. So that's, from my understanding, it's just very verbal, repetitive of language, I believe. And if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But I'm pretty confident in that, so yes. So yes, what did you guys think of the little game? Something a bit different, cool? Excellent, cool. All right, so yes, I'll leave it there, and thank you very much, guys, and have a good day.